Ladies and gentlemen, now we begin the symposium, Territory and Maritime Issues in East Asia and Their Origins, co-hosted by Japan Institute of International Affairs, Doshisha University Center for Study of South China Sea, and Faculty of Law, Doshisha University. At the outset, on behalf of the organizers, Mr. Yasunori Nakayama, Director General Acting of JIIA, gives us opening remarks. Mr. Nakayama, please. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This happens to be a Saturday, and this is a day of a gorgeous weather outside, but thank you very much indeed in choosing to attend our symposium, Territory and Maritime Issues in East Asia and Their Origins. This symposium is co-hosted by Doshisha University Center for the Study of South China Sea, Faculty of Law, Doshisha University, and our Institute, the JIIA. At our institute, in 2017, we started a program concerning issues of territory, sovereignty, and history. And in this program, we have organized various research projects and symposia. And here we are going to deal with an issue of territory and maritime issues in East Asia and the origins in this symposium. As you know, East Asia is becoming increasingly important in global economy. At the same time, this is the region where there are many territorial or maritime issues still unresolved. So, in view of the coexistence of such opportunities and risks, Japan has announced the strategy of India and Pacific free and open, and in that regard, we seek to establish and keep a freedom of navigation and the full-fledged establishment of free trade, as well as the importance of the rule of law. For various disputes in the region, we must seek for a peaceful resolution based upon international law, rejecting any change to the status quo with the use of force. In the symposium, we have invited experts of different fields, history, international law, and international politics. And we are here to have discussion on the origin of territorial and maritime issues. And we hope that this will lead us to consider ways to seek the establishment of the rule of law and peace and economic prosperity in East Asia. As a special keynote speaker, we are so honored to have Mr. Paul Reichler, who won an award in favor of the Philippines in 2016 in South China Sea Arbitration Tribunal. And he is going to enlighten us of the award and also development in South China Sea and the impact of this arbitral award on other territorial and maritime issues in East Asia, and will set the stage for the subsequent discussion, which will take place today. Last but not least, I'd like to take this opportunity to express my heartfelt thanks to Mr. Paul Reichler and the University of Doshisha, especially Professor Ryo Asano, Director of Doshisha University Center for South China Sea Study. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I want to, first of all, express my gratitude and deepest appreciation to JIIA and Doshisha University, Professor Asano, and Mr. Nakayama in particular, for bestowing upon me the honor of inviting me to be here with you. I'm humbled to be the person giving the keynote speech in the presence of so many outstanding scholars, any one of whom would probably be a more fitting keynote speaker than myself. So I am grateful for that. In fact, I feel like I'm walking down the philosopher's walk with all of the philosophers here in the room. So I'm in wonderful company. The topic that I have been asked to speak about is the South China Sea arbitration and beyond, China's approach to the law of the sea. And I will come to that in a moment. I was asked by the organizers before I address the main topic if I would make a few remarks about the International Court of Justice's recent advisory opinion issued on the 25th of February, last Monday, in the case involving the Chagos Archipelago. I had the honor of being present during the reading of that advisory opinion as one of the counsel to Mauritius. I had argued the case before the court in September last year, and have had the privilege of arguing before, among others, Judge Iwasawa. I have now had the honor of arguing before Judge Oda, Judge Iwata, and Judge Iwasawa. I also argued alongside one of your colleagues, Professor Shotaro Hamamoto of Kyoto University, who appeared as counsel for an advocate for Botswana and made an absolutely superb argument in support of Mauritius's position. Briefly, the case involved issue of decolonization of Mauritius in 1965, prior to the granting of independence of Mauritius by the British. The British themselves divided the colony of Mauritius, keeping for themselves a portion of that colony, specifically the Chagos Archipelago, and creating a new colony, which they called the British Indian Ocean Territories. They did that for the purpose of establishing a military base, military facilities, which were accomplished by virtue of leasing that territory to the United States. In 1968, Mauritius was granted independence, but without the Chagos Archipelago. As a sovereign state, Mauritius never stopped demanding the return of that piece of its territory, the Chagos Archipelago, which was severed from it by the British prior to the granting of independence. Because the British have reservations to their acceptance of ICJ jurisdiction, it was not possible for Mauritius to bring a contentious case against the United Kingdom. However, after many years of presenting the issue before the General Assembly of the United Nations, in 2017, the General Assembly adopted a resolution by an overwhelming vote to submit the matter to the International Court of Justice in a request for an advisory opinion. And specifically, the General Assembly asked the court to answer two questions. One, given that the Chagos Archipelago was severed from Mauritius prior to independence and remained under British rule, was the decolonization of Mauritius ever lawfully completed? And two, what are the consequences, the legal consequences today, of the continued colonial administration of the Chagos Archipelago? The court answered both questions And because these were advisory proceedings, every state that was that is a member of the United Nations had an opportunity to participate if they chose to do so. Some 30 states did, either through written submissions or at the oral hearings. The vast majority spoke in support of Mauritius's position. And the court on Monday issued its advisory opinion, in which it answered both of the questions put to it by the General Assembly. In response to the first question, the court decided that the decolonization of Mauritius was not lawfully completed. That is, that it was unlawful in 1965 for the British to dismember the colonial territory and to establish a new territory, because as of 1960, because as of 1965, international law had already crystallized into a rule, a customary rule, requiring the decolonization of subject peoples, of non-self-governing peoples, in accordance with the freely exercised self-determination of those peoples. And that the United Kingdom, it's the jet lag, I apologize. I just arrived yesterday. The United Kingdom had failed to respect the right of self-determination of the people of Mauritius. And in particular, in establishing the colony and the military base, it forcibly removed the native population of these islands and removed these people against their will, forcing them to leave their possessions behind, and deposited them in Mauritius and the Seychelles. It was, as the court found, a horrendous violation of their human rights. So in dismembering Mauritius on the verge of its independence and not granting independence to the entire colony, the UK was found not to have lawfully completed the decolonization of Mauritius. In response to the second question, the court decided that the ongoing colonial administration is an internationally unlawful act, and it is continuing in nature as long as the United Kingdom retains its administration over the Chagos Archipelago, which duly forms part of Mauritius. And the court further opined that in order to bring itself into compliance with its international legal obligations, the United Kingdom must end its colonial administration of the Chagos Archipelago as rapidly as possible. The court also said that because self-determination and decolonization are principles so fundamental to international law that they have erga omnes application, that other states, members of the United Nations, must cooperate in the decolonization of Mauritius and not contribute to or support the continued colonial administration by the British. Now, this is an advisory opinion, so it is not technically legally binding, as a judgment of the court would be. However, it is an authoritative and final determination of the legal issues and the legal obligations. It is hoped that the British, who have always professed and in many ways honored that profession, their commitment to the rule of law in international relations, it is hoped that they will comply with what the court said they should do. Mauritius, meanwhile, will return to the United Nations General Assembly, the court having answered the General Assembly's questions for further resolution implementing the court's opinion. If there are any questions later on, I'm happy to discuss them. So with that, I would like to return to my topic, South China Sea arbitration and beyond, and particularly China's approach to the law of the sea. Now, I would, by the way, may I ask the interpreters if I'm speaking at an appropriate pace? I'm not going too fast for you. I've learned through many years of arguing in the International Court of Justice that it doesn't help you if you speak too fast, because if the interpreters can't keep up with you, you're just talking to yourself. I'll keep an eye on you, and please give me a signal if I start going too fast. The award is over 400 pages, so naturally I will speak very briefly and summarize. I did give a presentation on the award in some detail before JIIA 2 years ago, and my presentation is in one of the publications by JIIA of that period. So if anybody is interested, you can refer to that. But for today, let me say that while there were many issues in the case, there are two that stand out above the others. The first was China's claim based on its so-called nine-dash line to not only sovereign rights, but actually sovereignty over all of the waters of the South China Sea within the contours of this nine-dash line. If you've seen it depicted, you would know how exaggerated a claim this is. The South China Sea is shaped like a bucket, with the top being the mainland coast of southern China. The nine-dash line is like the tongue of a cow, which reaches down from the top of the bucket almost entirely to the bottom. And it extends more than 600 miles from the Chinese mainland coast. And it comes very close to the Philippines, to Malaysia, Brunei, Indonesia, and in the west to Vietnam. It comes within 35 to 50 miles of their coasts, thus depriving all of these states of the vast majority of their entitlements, their 200-mile entitlements, under the Law of the Sea Convention. Now, China makes this claim based on its alleged historic rights. And it claims that its historic rights supersede those of its neighbors under UNCLOS. Now, what the tribunal decided is that this is nonsense. It's an exaggerated claim which has no basis in international law. The tribunal decided this unanimously. It held that when the states parties adopted UNCLOS, the Law of the Sea Convention, in 1982, they specifically rejected the idea that any previously claimed historic rights in areas beyond the 12-mile territorial sea would exist. The new regimes for the exclusive economic zone and continental shelf out to 200 miles, that is beyond the 12-mile territorial sea, were an agreement by the states parties that replaced any previously existing claims based on historic or economic rights. And thus, China could not lawfully claim to have historic rights that went beyond those that to which it itself was entitled under UNCLOS. The tribunal further found, also unanimously, that even under general international law principles, China could not make a credible claim of historic rights. Under general international law, a claim of historic rights must be based on the continuous administration under claim of title over a long period of time and with the acquiescence of third states. And there was no evidence to support China's claims in this regard in the South China Sea. Indeed, up until the end of World War II, China had never made any claim to any of the sea south of the Paracel Islands, which are far to the north in the South China Sea. Indeed, they hadn't made claims to the sea. They had made claims to those islands. There were periods lasting centuries when China itself, the emperors, forbade any kind of commerce, any kind of Chinese commerce in the South China Sea as part of an effort to close China off from the influences of the then European powers. So the idea of any continuous administration under claim of title over a prolonged period of time, let alone with acquiescence of neighboring states, just had no evidence whatsoever to support it. So on this issue, the tribunal ruled that the 9-line claim was unlawful. There was no basis for it. The other major issue decided by the tribunal, which I will only touch on very briefly because of time, and I do want to allow time for discussion and questions, had to do with the entitlements, the maritime entitlements of islands, and particularly the Spratly Islands. It was China's position that it was sovereign over all of the Spratly Islands, and that they constituted an archipelago, and thus straight lines could be drawn connecting the outermost features from which maritime entitlements up to 200 miles would extend. The tribunal rejected that thesis correctly. First, it decided it did not need to determine who had sovereignty over these disputed islands, because maritime entitlements do not depend on who is sovereign. They depend on the nature of the particular insular feature. It also found, quite rightly, that under UNCLOS, it was impossible to claim archipelagic status for a group of outer islands, because UNCLOS substituted for the rule of customary international law a new paradigm for archipelagic status. And it defines how and under what circumstances a state can consider itself an archipelagic state. And it's very clear that China does not qualify under UNCLOS. The tribunal went on to find further that these insular features were not capable of sustaining human habitation or economic life on their own, and therefore they generated no more than a 12-mile entitlement, regardless of who is sovereign. Now, the significance of this for these rulings for the Philippines and for the other states in the regions was this: that China was limited in its entitlements to a 200-mile exclusive economic zone and continental shelf from its mainland coast. And even if it was sovereign over any islands in the Spratlys, they generated no more than a 12-mile entitlement. When one overlays the picture of China's entitlements on the entitlements, the 200-mile entitlements from the coasts of Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Vietnam in particular, one finds that that China, in fact, does not overlap much of the entitlements of the other states. That is, all of the other states would get to enjoy almost the entirety of their 200-mile entitlements under UNCLOS. Now, China has rejected, formally rejected the award. As you all know, it decided not to participate in the proceedings, and it tried throughout to discredit the arbitration, discredit the proceedings, and it has denounced the award. But significantly, it has, while it has denounced the award, it has not withdrawn from UNCLOS, the convention, and indeed, it has tried to defend its positions by arguing that they are consistent with UNCLOS, that the tribunal made a wrong interpretation of the treaty, but that China's position itself is consistent with UNCLOS. I think this is very significant for reasons that I will come to. For instance, on historic rights, they argue that the convention does not replace historic rights established under general international law with the regime of the exclusive economic zone and continental shelf, but they exist side by side. I think China is probably the only state in the world that makes this argument, and it was rejected by the tribunal unanimously. But I think it is significant that China tries to cloak its position within the confines of international law and UNCLOS in particular. On islands, again, China says that that the Spratlys represent an outlying archipelago of China, and that the archipelagic status is well-founded under general international law. It says the regime of continental states outlying archipelagos is well established. Well, again, this is entirely inconsistent with UNCLOS and the regime for archipelagic states. But it is interesting that China argues that this is consistent with UNCLOS. I think any expert on the convention and on the law of the sea would disagree with China's position. But again, it is not insignificant that China is attempting to defend itself as behaving consistently with international law and with the convention in particular. Let me touch upon what has happened between China and the Philippines since the publication of the award in July of 2016. Well, first, as you know, there was a change in government of the Philippines at about that time, and they adopted a different policy toward China. They made a decision that they would not, indeed they could not, abandon the award and the benefits that they obtained under the award, but they decided not to insist on compliance directly to the Chinese. They have adopted a policy of friendliness toward China, and they have reaped massive Chinese investment and increased trade in return. Also, the Chinese have allowed Philippine fishermen to return to fish and exercise their fishing rights around Scarborough Shoal, which was one of the important issues to the Philippines in the case. In that sense, China is complying with one of its obligations under the award. And in regard to the maritime area that lies between the Spratly Islands and the Philippine coast at Palawan, an area called Reed Bank, which is considered to be likely to have huge petroleum resources in the continental shelf, where China had previously used force to keep the Philippines from exploring for oil in this area, which is 100 miles off the Philippine coast, so plainly within the Philippine continental shelf and exclusive economic zone. But China has approached the Philippines about joint development, and the states are in discussion about that. And in this way, it may very well be that the Philippines gets to enjoy the resources of its continental shelf in collaboration with China. A word or two on the attitudes and actions of other South China Sea coastal states after the issuance of the award. Of course, the award is binding only between China and the Philippines. However, the principles that were established by the tribunal, that is the rejection of the lawfulness of the nine dash line, is as beneficial to Vietnam and Malaysia and Indonesia as it is to the Philippines. But something to take note of is that since the award, China has avoided confrontations with the other South China Sea states. It has not engaged in any drilling or exploration for oil within 200 miles of their coasts, as it had started to do off the coast of Vietnam before the arbitral award. And nor has it challenged their possession of the islands that they already possess, these other states, the Philippines and Vietnam in particular, in the South China Sea, is the Spratlys. To be sure, China has consolidated its hold on the eight or so islands in this group that it has already possessed. It's built military facilities on them, with some regard as a threat. But it has not attempted to dispossess Vietnam or Malaysia or the Philippines of any of the islands that they hold. So China has been cautious, not aggressive vis-a-vis the other states in the wake of the arbitral award. Looking at the interests of the other states, of course, Vietnam and Indonesia in particular have interests similar to those of the Philippines, and they have made very clear and public their denunciation, their refusal to accept the nine-dash line and China's exaggerated claims. Similarly, they reject China's claims of exaggerated entitlements from islands. But they have not been able to engage in any action, largely because they have acted individually rather than collectively. It's very difficult for them to act through ASEAN, because ASEAN includes certain states that are very loyal to China. And ASEAN only acts by consensus. And China has skillfully insisted on dealing with each of these states on a bilateral basis. Whereas if the South China Sea states, the major South China Sea states, are to achieve any assurance to themselves of their rights, it's quite clear they will have to act collectively, that there's strength in numbers, and that they can bring greater pressure on China to accommodate their lawful and legitimate interests if they act together. And I'm referring particularly to Vietnam and Indonesia and the Philippines. It will take collective action by those three at least before China comes around to recognizing the rights that the arbitral tribunal made clear that they have. Now, I thought it in the few minutes that I have left, I would leave the South China Sea and talk about China's neighbors to the east by way of a parallel and see if there are some common threads here. In regard to China's maritime relationship with South Korea, of course, they share a boundary which is yet to be established in the Yellow Sea. There are incipient negotiations. One interesting thing here is that China's approach has been that before the parties can agree on a maritime boundary, they should agree on the equitable principles that will govern the formation of the boundary. Now, of course, the ICJ, ITLOS, Annex 7 arbitral tribunals have all adopted an approach, a methodology, for achieving exactly that, an equitable boundary. In fact, the convention itself says that the boundary in the exclusive economic zone and continental shelf should be based on equity. And that is the so-called three-stage process. First, drawing an equidistance line or a median line, then assessing whether there are relevant geographic circumstances which make the equidistance line inequitable, in which case you would make an adjustment to it, and then you would test for the proportionality or lack of proportionality of the final line. But China takes its own approach, and in particular, in the delimitation of the continental shelf, they have come up with their own unique formulation, that instead of a median line, that the South Koreans should recognize that the vast majority of the seabed in the Yellow Sea, the sediments, come from China. And because they come from Chinese rivers, that the vast majority of the continental shelf should belong to China. Now, I cannot, I don't want to belittle that argument too much because we actually made it on behalf of Bangladesh in before ITLOS. This was a case between Bangladesh and Myanmar, and it was the first time a court or tribunal had ever been called upon to delimit beyond 200 miles. So coastal configuration was not relevant. It was more geology and geomorphology of the seabed. And one of the arguments that we made on behalf of Bangladesh was that the vast majority of the seabed, that is the shelf, beyond 200 miles, was formed by these enormous river systems, the Ganges and the Brahmaputra, that were washing down from Bangladesh and India. And there were no major rivers from Myanmar feeding into the seabed in the Bay of Bengal. We thought it was worth a try. It was unanimously rejected, and probably for good reason. The court was uninterested in where the sediments came from. The only issue was whether the sediment was there, whether there was a shelf, and whether there was a pertinence by the coastal state. And so China makes an argument in the Yellow Sea that has been rejected by the only court to consider it. Very briefly, and let me talk about China's claims, maritime claims, vis-a-vis Japan. China, at least publicly, has rejected the idea that the boundary is formed in the East China Sea is formed by the median line. Japan, by its law, claims that the boundary, of course, shall be determined by agreement, but in the absence of agreement, essentially it adopts the median line or equidistance as a basis of determining the boundary, which is very consistent with UNCLOS. China rejects that, and they've made that clear in public statements at least since 2015, And let me read from what their Ministry of Foreign Affairs wrote in 2015. China claims a 200-mile exclusive economic zone, and China's continental shelf in the East China Sea prolongs naturally to the Okinawa Trough. Now, this, of course, is a very serious issue for Japan. Of course, if China claims, in terms of the EEZ, that doesn't depend on the seabed. It's distinct from the continental shelf. They claim a 200-mile EEZ. Japan claims a 200-mile EEZ. The distance is less than 400 miles. So one would think that the overlap would be settled by means of a median line, despite what China says. Certainly that is what UNCLOS would the convention would provide, and any international court or tribunal would decide. But the issue of the continental shelf is a very interesting one. It's another example of China ostensibly basing a claim on UNCLOS. That is, they don't say, we don't care what's in the convention. They say, they make an argument that they try to base on, root in the convention, just as some of these other arguments we've seen about human rights, and they take a look at Article 76.1 of the convention, which provides two bases for claiming a continental shelf. One is the 200-mile legal entitlement, and then natural prolongation. And they say there is a natural prolongation of the shelf off of China's coast that extends to the Okinawa Trough, which is very, very close to Japan, as you know better than I. So the question is, of course, is how would you delimit the continental shelf in the East China Sea? Would you take the 200-mile claims, the overlap, draw a median line, which I believe is Japan's position, and I believe that's the correct position, or would you compare China's claim to the Okinawa shelf, to the Okinawa trough, with Japan's median line, 200-mile claim, and then put a median line between the two of those, which of course would put the boundary much closer to Japan than to China. This is an issue which is, China's claim, I think, is extreme, but it is not entirely implausible, because if you read Article 76.1, which talks about both a continental shelf limit based on natural prolongation and a legal limit of 200 miles, the language does not expressly say that the 200-mile limit prevails over the natural prolongation claim. Now, I believe that Japan has the much better argument here, but this is another example of China making its own interpretation of UNCLOS and contending that it is in compliance with, that it respects the rule of law, and particularly UNCLOS. Now, just if I may just conclude in a couple of minutes with these observations on China's stated commitment to UNCLOS and the rule of law. I do think, first of all, we must recognize China remains a party to UNCLOS, and it continues to state that it is committed to UNCLOS. I think it's important for international law and international relations that China does not renounce or reject the convention and that it claims to be in compliance. I think this may be an important starting point for thinking about solutions to some of these problems. Now, the problem exists, I think, certainly from Japan's perspective, but it would be a perspective that I share, that China has adopted some extremely self-serving and almost implausible interpretations of UNCLOS. So what do you do? China, now, as we see, they reject arbitration. They won't participate. It's clear they won't participate. They would have to have a dramatic change in policy view to participate. So the arbitration provisions of the convention really aren't helpful for those states, whether it's Japan or Korea or the states along the South China Sea. It might be possible to instigate an arbitration and to get an award for what it's worth, an interpretation, and a rejection of China's view, but knowing in advance that China won't participate and will probably refuse to accept it diminishes the value of such an approach. So what can be done? Well, the convention also provides for compulsory mediation or compulsory conciliation, if you will. Now, this is an approach that actually worked between Timor-Leste and Australia, the only time it's been ever invoked, and it produced an agreement. Is it possible that China would accept compulsory conciliation if it were instigated by Vietnam, for example, or Indonesia? Well, it might not be very likely, I don't know, but conciliation is not arbitration. And conciliation is voluntary. The result is a recommendation. It's not a binding judgment. So at least it's something to think about. And if the current position of China is to reject all forms of third-party solution, then maybe that policy will soften over time, at least in regard to conciliation as opposed to arbitration. Another possibility, and of course you'll forgive me if I have advisory opinion on the brain, it now appears more attractive than it did last week. But seriously though, there is the possibility, for example, of going to ITLOS and seeking an advisory opinion, which is not a contentious proceeding and would not require China's agreement, but an advisory opinion by the 21 member ITLOS, which includes a Chinese judge, very distinguished Chinese judge, by the way, Judge Gao, and raising the question of do historic rights or his claims of historic rights survive the convention and the regime of the EEZ and the continental shelf? Is it possible for a continental state that has a few offshore islands to claim that it is an archipelagic state under UNCLOS? These are questions very suitable for an advisory opinion, an authoritative statement on the law, not by five arbitrators, although I don't want to diminish the importance of the arbitral tribunal in the South China. These are five of the world's best experts on law of the sea and men of impeccable integrity. But 21-member UNCLOS, that would be an advisory opinion that would be difficult for China to reject. Or on the question of the continental shelf, does a claim between states that are separated by less than 400 miles, can a state get beyond the median line based on an argument of geology? That is, they can extend all the way to the Okinawa Trough based on geology, even though Japan has a 200-mile entitlement, as do they, and the proper solution would be a median line. This is an issue that affects other states around the world, too. In fact, it's part of the litigation before the ICJ now between Nicaragua and Colombia. But with that, I think it's I've gone a little beyond my time. I hope you don't mind. But I think this is an appropriate place for me to stop and welcome comments from my friend Professor Sakamoto, and then any questions that you might have. I love questions and answers, so I hope you will have some questions for me. Thank you very much.
Mr. Reichler, thank you very much for giving us a very convincing presentation based on your ample experience. Next, we would like to hear the comment from Professor Shigeki Sakamoto. Professor Sakamoto, please.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. I'm Shigeki Sakamoto, Professor of Doshisha University. Thank you very much for your excellent and insightful presentation. As Mr. Reichler has rightly pointed out in his paper in the journal by the JIIA, UNCLOS is a very special convention. It was received by the international community as a constitution of the ocean. It has been one of the most successful treaties in the history of international law. UNCLOS is one of the most complex international treaties that have ever been negotiated. While the convention confirmed many provisions of customary international law codified in the 1958 Geneva Conventions, its main achievement was the progressive development of international law, like the declaration of the area and mineral resources as common heritage of mankind and establishment of the mineral resource establishment international regime governing activities of exploration for and exploitation of the mineral resources of the area, and introduction of EEZ, and also the definition of the regime of island, and so on. The contribution of UNCLOS to the rule of law may be seen from a substantial and from a procedural point of view. Substantially, UNCLOS tried to deal comprehensively with all aspects of the law of the sea. Its provisions are drafted so as to encompass, in many cases, even new problems like bunkering. Of course, there are limits to the comprehensiveness of UNCLOS as it now stands. Like there are some kind of challenge which cannot be resolved through interpretation of UNCLOS, like the question of the conservation and sustainable use of marine biological diversity beyond areas of national jurisdiction, so-called BBNJ. Now, right now, it's under discussion of the Intergovernmental Conference in the United Nations. Procedurally, the main contribution of UNCLOS to the rule of law consists in the rules establishing compulsory judicial or arbitral settlement of dispute. The convention provides for a mechanism in the form of compulsory procedure entailing binding decision, which aims at ensuring compliance with the provision of the convention. As a matter of fact, UNCLOS contains many ambiguous provisions as a result of compromise reached among states in order to reconcile their conflicting interests and differing view. Many provisions were left for the future development through the interpretation or application of UNCLOS. International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea and Arbitration under Annex 7 of UNCLOS have been clarifying the provision of UNCLOS by delivering decision and awards in contentious case, not to generate fragmentation of international law. As Professor Oxman pointed out, the coexistence of various judicial voices like International Court of Justice, ITRAS, oral arbitration, improved the growth of international law and the settlement of dispute. For example, the award of South China Sea arbitration is now very, very important for the interpretation of Article 121 defining the regime of island. On January 2013, the Philippines submitted its dispute with China over the Spratly Islands to arbitration under Annex 7 of UNCLOS. Prior to this action, on August 2006, China lodged a declaration with the Secretary General of the United Nations stating that it would exclude the dispute stipulated in subparagraph A, B, and C, paragraph 1, Article 298 of UNCLOS, from compulsory conflict resolution procedure. The Philippines argued that China is claiming sovereign rights and jurisdiction over all waters within the Nine Dash Line to bypass jurisdiction restriction, even though it is only allowed to claim rights and jurisdiction over waters measured from land, including island. It has been 2 years and half now since an arbitral tribunal ruled that Nine Dash Line asserted by China in the South China Sea is in violation of UNCLOS on July 2016. During this time, China has made numerous political, military, and legal attempts to negate the effects of arbitral award. Immediately after the ruling on September 2016, China and Russia held a joint military exercise off the coast of Guangdong province in the South China Sea. Despite the Beijing's claim that construction of artificial islands in the South China Sea is for peaceful purposes, but mischief leaf and fiery cross were equipped with jammer system with exclusively military application in April 2018. China moved quickly to repudiate the tribunal ruling ahead of ASEAN Foreign Ministers' meeting. Chinese Foreign Minister traveled to Laos on July 24, 2016, to meet with the foreign minister of Singapore, Brunei, Myanmar, and Cambodia individually in an effort to divide ASEAN. Cambodia was promised more than $500 million in grant aid over the next 3 years, which was enough to convince Prime Minister Hun Sen to assert that Cambodia does not support the arbitral award. The Hangzhou Summit communique from the G20 held in Hangzhou on September 2016 makes no reference to the South China Sea Arbitration Award. At the same summit, only the United States and Japan mentioned South China Sea ruling. Even the Philippines make no reference. On the other hand, Russia stated that it supported China in rebuffing the ruling. Shortly afterward, during an October 2016 visit, the President Duterte concluded an agreement with China on 13 points covering everything from tourism to agriculture. This was accompanied by a total of $24 billion in economic cooperation. Duterte did say in a political speech on July 25, 2016, that the Philippines strongly affirm and respect the arbitration tribunal's award. Yet, it is hard to escape the conclusion that situation is moving in the opposite direction. The dispute in the South China Sea are more than bilateral conflicts. They are an issue that now involves entire region. The approval of Chinese 9-1 claim, which would turn other countries EEZ into China's own waters, simply reflects the commitment of the international community to the reign of force. After all, the Philippines, which was plaintiff in the case, and together with the defendant China, is obliged to implement the decision in its capacity as litigant from viewpoint of international law. On June 26, 2016, immediately before the South China Sea Arbitral Award, China and Russia issued the declaration of the Russian Federation and People's Republic of China on the promotion of international law. The declaration contained the passage, "The Russian Federation and the People's Republic of China reaffirm the principle of peaceful settlement of dispute." Despite this, China continues to disregard the arbitral award. the reason can be found in that they express their firm conviction that state shall resolve their dispute through dispute settlement means and mechanism that they have agreed upon. The Philippines' unilateral application falls outside this principle of peaceful settlement of dispute. Moreover, in 2018, an article of more than 540 pages titled "The South China Sea Arbitration Awards, a Critical Study," were published in the name of the Chinese Society of International Law in the Chinese Journal of International Law. It offered extensive criticism of the award and called for it to be invalidated. However, as a party to UNCLOS, China must acknowledge that the decision is binding in accordance with Article 219(6). The international community must not consent to China disregarding a binding decision, but should continue its effort to turn the South China Sea into peaceful sea, where UNCLOS applies. Today, distinguished practitioner Mr. Leichler, in his excellent paper, he referred that, quote, "We may have an imperfect international legal order, but it's far better than having no rule-based system at all. The response to the international legal order should be to continue working so make the system better and stronger, and the rules more universally enforceable. There is a long way to go, but since the World War II, great progress has been made, and there is no reason to give up efforts to make all states, including most powerful states like China, take legal accountability for their breaches of the applicable rule," unquote. We should take this word to heart. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Sakamoto. Well, actually, it is time to end this particular part of the program, but this has been a great discussion from the two experts, so we'd like to open the floor for any questions or comments. Please raise your hand and please state your name and organizational affiliation before you make a question or comment. No question or comment at this point in time.
My name is Harada with the Defense Research Institute. Thank you very much for a very enlightening talk. I have a question to Mr. Reichler. In your talk, as you stated in your talk, China has rejected the arbitral award. On the other hand, they stay within the UNCLOS as a member signatory. And it seems to be finding a basis of their claims within UNCLOS. I'm sure that they are studying UNCLOS very much and very, very closely. If China, after the award of arbitration, if China tries to justify its claims, and if it tries to find a basis for their claims. What other argument do you think China is likely to put forward to justify their claims? I see none. In the interest of time, I would like to ask Mr. Reckler to answer that particular question. What other arguments China is likely to take?
Thank you very much for asking such a good and very interesting question about an important topic. With your permission, I would like to enlarge upon it for a moment. And let me ask a question rhetorically, which I will then do my best to answer. Why does China go to such lengths to defend its positions as consistent with UNCLOS, with the convention? I think that that is a very important question, and that is really at the heart of what Mr. Harada is asking. They're a big power. Why don't they just say, we don't care? We're the biggest power in this part of the world. We want the South China Sea, and there's nothing anybody can do to stop us. Well, I think it's important to think about that. And of course, I don't know what is going on inside the Politburo in Beijing. But what I imagine is that they have come to the conclusion that it is important for China's own self-interest that they present themselves to the world as respectful of international law, as respectful of a rules-based international order. And this is very important because states like China and the United States much of the time defend what they do, even when defending it may be very difficult, on the basis of international law. Why? Because they must believe it's in their own national self-interest to do so. And why is that? Because by defending their conduct on the basis of international law, they gain more influence with other states, more influence in the international community in general, than if they simply said, might makes right, we are the strongest, we will do what we want, and you have no choice but to accept it. In other words, what we call, what political scientists call, soft power. Soft power is real. And in the competition for influence, in the effort to defend, promote, expand a nation's self-interest, the ability to present itself as law-abiding, as reinforcing the system, as behaving in a way that is viewed as legally correct, is very important to its national interest. And this explains one of the reasons why, as imperfect as the system is, thank you to Professor Sakamoto, it is still important that we have this system, because it imposes some constraints on behavior, on states' behavior. And if we are in a dialogue about what international law requires, what does the rule of law require, that's much healthier. It's a basis on which we can discuss with China. We might not agree now. It might be a long way before we can agree, but we are in the right kind of relationship rather than confronting each other on simply on the basis of power and might. Now, I remember at Davos, shortly, I can't remember which year, I think it was either 2017, I believe, so it was 2 years ago, shortly after the presidential elections in the United States, President Xi went to Davos and proclaimed that China is the defender of the international legal order. Well, we wonder how to take that. I don't want to be critical here. It's not my place. I don't want to put my hosts in an embarrassing situation. But my own personal reaction as an international lawyer, somebody who spent his whole life and career working for what I think is the strengthening of the international legal order in my own small way, case by case, argument by argument, building the prestige and the reputation of the International Court of Justice, I say, good. Because if he says that, then we can respond to him. Not Paul Reichler, I don't talk to President Xi, but the nations of the world, the states of the world can respond by saying, that's very good. However, when you behave this way, you are undermining the legal order rather than strengthening it, rather than showing China, great state that it is a responsible and law-abiding international citizen. There is a lot we can disagree on, but we are speaking the same vocabulary with the same language, the language of law. This is very important. So we then get to the issue of how can we hold China legally accountable, as Professor Sakamoto said. First, through dialogue, through reminding them, through argument. I think engagement is important. We see Chinese scholars, Chinese international lawyers. There's been a growth in that industry, international lawyers in China. I'm sure you've come in contact with them. Many of them now come to lecture at or get graduate degrees at law schools in the United States. And these are opportunities to engage. Now, the study, the 500-page study that my friend Professor Sakamoto referred to, it seems like propaganda written by lawyers for the Chinese Communist Party, although it's signed by the Chinese Society of International Law. Well, there may be some limits on what their lawyers can say in Beijing. But it's important to engage with them. They have serious international lawyers and serious scholars. And by engaging, the hope is we can show that in a rules-based international order, which is in everyone's best interest, including the interests of the great powers. After all, who wants the stability of a rules-based international order more than the most powerful? Because they have the most influence in setting the rules. But we can, in time, when I say we, I mean all of us in this room, around the world, those of us scholars, students, scholars in particular, even more than litigators like me, can show them that in a true rules-based international order, which we all strive for, which is in every nation's best interest, it's healthy for a state to lose once in a while. Because there is no better way to demonstrate your commitment to the rule of law than to have your case adjudicated by an impartial third party, to lose, and then comply. You have maybe lost something in the short run, but you have demonstrated that you are a state that cares about, that is committed to international law, and you have strengthened the system. And of course, I'm describing Japan in the whaling case. maybe it was a loss on some level. In the long run, it was a great victory for Japan as a nation, as a member of the international community, because of the way Japan responded. I'd also point to India in the arbitration with Bangladesh. India quickly accepted an award that was very difficult for it in that maritime delimitation. These states have shown they are committed to a rules-based international order. I say about the United States, we should be doing the same. We could do no better thing for international peace and security than to demonstrate our commitment to a rules-based international order by submitting a dispute to the court, even if we lose, and then accepting the result. Imagine the prestige that the United States would have following that. And with that, I would hope that these arguments, that these points can be made to the Chinese. If you're not speaking to President Xi directly, you are speaking with Chinese scholars, with Chinese international lawyers, with the next generation of Chinese leaders. And we have to work step by step to bring China into the same mentality as Japan. They shouldn't be following Russia's example. They should be following Japan's example. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Reichler. Starting from the comprehensive analysis of the presentation on the South China Sea arbitration, we have heard your views on the comment and also the emphasis on the rules-based international order. RBIS, a rules-based international system, is a term that is often used in the West nowadays, and I believe you talked about the importance of that, and also you gave us some advice as to how Japan could react and interact with China in the future regarding these territorial issues. We would like to thank you very much for this very fine opening session with your keynote address. Please give the speakers once again a big hand. So it is time to resume with the panel discussion. I would now like to have the panel discussion on the territory and maritime issues in East Asia and their origins. In this panel discussion, as panelists, we have Professor Okamoto of Kyoto Prefecture University, Mr. Takai, Special Research Fellow of the Sasaka Peace Foundation, and Professor Sakai of Kyoto University. And discussants are Distinguished Visiting Professor Agawa of Doshi University and Professor Murata of Doshi University. Moderator is Professor Asano of Doshi University, Center for Study of South China Sea. And Mr. Paul Reichler and Professor Sakamoto will join the discussion after comments by the discussants. And in view of time, we had to cut short the Q&A. But we do have time available for question and answers later on as well. So, Professor Asano, would you please moderate the panel discussion? I'm Asano. Let me be seated. Remain seated. We would like to begin the panel discussion on territory maritime issues in East Asia and their origins. We would like to go to the origins of territorial maritime issues in East Asia, and this will be on page 2 in the Japanese program, and on page 6 in the English program. There are four issues to be discussed here. And number one, historical and contemporary Chinese perceptions of borders and historical memory will be discussed by Professor Okamoto. The second issue, commercial activities conducted on islands in East Asia by the Japanese civilians before World War II, and the responses of the Japanese government in connection with these commercial activities. And number three, the disposition of territories under the San Francisco Peace Treaty will be dealt by Mr. Takai. And number four, the postures of various countries on the current international maritime legal order, including UNCLOS and other legal instruments, will be dealt by Professor Sakai. And we would like to hear from each of them for 15 minutes and have discussants, Professors Agawa and Murata, to give comments. So may I ask the panelists, first of all, Professor Okamoto, to come to the podium.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. I am Okamoto.
The task given to me is to take a look at the history, Chinese history.
Well,
actually, it seems to sound like a very massive field, although this is a field of mine. And as you can find in my resume, and as a historian, I have copied some Chinese characters. I'm sure that no one really understands what they mean, but that's one trait being a Chinese historian.
As has been explained,
because of the time pressure, I would like to just pick out main points,
and I will also
show some maps and tables on the screen as I go through my points.
Mr. Reichler,
used the legal language. And the legal language is a common language we can use in a dialogue or in engaging with China. Very encouraging words indeed. But on the other side of the coin, we are not speaking the same language with China today. What they say and what we say from Japan are not at all in line with each other. That's where we find today. But what is the historical background to the different courses the two countries have taken so far?
So,
from the history study point of view, I would like to make some comments.
The
theme is China's territorial sovereignty, and that's the area I would like to focus upon.
At the outset,
for a territorial sovereignty, I don't think I need to make any explanation about this,
but
in China, this terminology, territorial sovereignty, was born only a little over 100 years ago. Before that, China didn't have a notion of territorial sovereignty.
Then,
100 years ago, or before that, what was the order China had back in those days? And in your resume, you can find a section talking about the Qin Dynasty's world order. It seems that my voice is too loud for you to bear. So I will lower my voice a bit. So this is in Qin Dynasty. I cannot go through the details, but there are four different categories in the Qin's world order. First, for Fuxi, linked by trade and commerce, and tributaries, which is called Xuguo.
tributaries and vessels such as Korea, Ryukyu, and Vietnam, and Fanbu, indicated by a blue, Tibet, Mongolia, and Chinese Turkestan today, and Chinese provinces where Chinese as an ethnic group lived. And this is the table that shows how four categories have evolved over the years. From the original Chinese documents, I made such a table of showing the evolution in the Chinese terms for the world order. First, Fuxi, linked by trade, such as Western powers and Japan. They are shown at the bottom of this table. And those states had a relationship with China through treaties, and early on, they already had diplomatic relations with China, the Qin Dynasty. But the question lies with other categories. Shuguo, the tributaries, and Fanbu. For the question of territorial sovereignty, these two categories have a very important point for us to consider. Tributaries and Fanbu, they are shown as two separate categories, but in my resume, there is another term called fanshu, and in certain cases, shuguo or tributaries and fanbu are grouped into one larger group called fanshu. After Sino-Japanese War, a Korean peninsula became like this. After Sino-Japanese War, Korea won independence, and it became, or it renamed itself, our Korean Empire. It was a tributary of China, but it became independent after Sino-Japanese War. So it achieved independence. It had graduated from the status of tributaries. And according to the document at the time, Korea grew out of being a fanshu, Chinese dependencies. So tributaries and fanbu are often grouped together in the documents back in those days. We have two slightly different blue colors, and the tributaries and fanbu are administered in different ways by Qin Dynasty, but often the case these two categories were treated more or less the same by Qin Dynasty China. I give you further explanation in my resume, but I will not go through them in detail. If you have any questions about such categorization, please raise a question later. So tributaries and vassals such as Korea and Ryukyu and Vietnam, by the end of 19th century, all of them grew out of the position or status of tributaries and vassals, and that is what I mean by a loss of shuguos or tributaries. And Korea also became an independent state in 1897, and China then experienced a very tough days of a scramble for concessions, where Western powers came to China and they partitioned China into their small concessions that continued to the end of 19th century. And Chinese at the time called this period a period of fear of partition. And Qin Dynasty leadership was so afraid of China being divided into smaller concessions by Western powers. But those tributaries were lost by China, but Fanbu still remained with China. And Fanbu in Qin Dynasty China was more or less grouped together the same way with the tributaries, but China wanted to keep Fanbu under their control. Otherwise, China would face a more tougher danger. And that's how Qin Dynasty leadership looked at the situation. So Fanbu, such as Tibet, Mongolia, and Sichuan, Chinese Turkestan, as I described toward the end of page 1 to page 2, Chinese diplomats who were stationed in Western countries who learned Western histories and philosophies began to call Fanbu Chinese colonies. And that sentiment was strengthened in 1880s and 1890s. And those Fanbus were therefore called gradually. But in Chinese characters, the word Shudi looks very similar to tributaries. And from Western powers and Japanese point of view, those Shudi apparently look the same with Fanbu or tributaries. So Chinese leadership felt something that they have to do something in order to escape the danger of being divided by Western powers. From the North Russian powers and British India, this area is sandwiched by these two powers. Imperialist states try to exercise their influence over such regions. And in the face of such a threat, China wanted to keep those areas such as Tibet and Mongolia within their influence. And in 1905, even before that, in this map, the whole China is painted red, and this means that China was under an unity. It seems to indicate their efforts to build a nation state. Chinese as a nation, it was in a sense a birth of nationalism in China. And Shudi or Fanbu, such as Tibet, Mongolia, and Chinese Turkestan, how can they be positioned under such circumstances? And in that effort, China found a concept of territorial sovereignty. Before that, suzerainty, which was a rather ambiguous notion, once the word they used to use, be it Shudi or Shuguo or Fanbu, all of them were translated into English as dependencies. It simply means a dependent relationship on China. But if Tibet and Mongolia are simply called a dependency, and they might be taken away from China, like the case with Korea. So they decided to begin to use the word territory rather than using the word suzerainty. And this notion, in Japanese, was more or less used in Chinese context also. In 1911 to 1912, when China was transformed from a Qin dynasty to a republic, sovereignty began to be more or less established in the Chinese language as sovereignty used in the word of territorial sovereignty. So the notion of territorial sovereignty took roots in China. But those areas like Tibet or Mongolia or Korea were Fanguo and Fanbu. And they were also called Fanshu. Tibet, Mongolia, not only them, but also Korea and Vietnam, which were tributaries, were also regarded as Fanshu. But Korea was taken away from China's influence and was given independence, and they didn't want Tibet or Mongolia or other Shugu or Fanbu fall in the same destiny like Korea. They didn't want to have their independence from China. So this is China in the Republican era, and this is a map used in China back in those days, and this is their territory, and the territory lost, the area they want to regain is what was distributed in China in those days. So this was more or less a strong imprint in Chinese concept of territorial sovereignty. And that seems to be an original starting point of the notion of territorial sovereignty in China. So the current disputes seem to go back to such an era and history as their origin. Thank you very much.
Professor Okamoto, thank you very much. Next, may I invite Mr. Takai? Good afternoon, I'm Takai. I'm here to discuss the incorporation of islands into the territory of Japan. I have many things that I would like to talk about, but only given 15 minutes. So I might have to speak fast. I'm sorry to the interpreters. So first of all, I think you're all aware of this. How do we determine the scope of the territory? The acquisition of territory by state and the scope of the territory are regulated by international law. This is a basic understanding. And I'm sure you would recognize that Japan is a country which has been abiding very strictly by the international law. And but despite of this diligency, we don't have Takeshima regarding Senkaku. We still have disputes. And international law discusses four elements in terms of territory title. One is accretion and occupation. Second, now, Accretion is acquiring territory created by natural phenomena. The most recent example is Nishinoshima. The subsea volcano has erupted and the territory has expanded. So it is a natural phenomenon within the territory of Japan which increased the land territory. So once you have a volcano eruption and an island is created, it already automatically becomes the country's territory. Now, I would like to limit my discussion here to occupation here and not talk about prescription, but occupation is acquiring territory that does not belong to any other state. But there are conditions for this. The territory needs to be terra nullius. In other words, it is not a territory of anyone else. It is unoccupied. And a mere discovery of the territory leads to what is known as an inchoate title to territory. There needs to be an intent to occupy the territory and the act to exercise effective control over the territory for a prolonged period of time. That's occupation. Now, what are the bilateral or mutual means of acquiring territory? In the form of signing treaties or mutual agreement. There are twofold here. One is annexation, a transfer of a territory in its entirety. The most famous is 1910 Japan-Korea Treaty. The Korean Peninsula became a Japanese territory, and this was mutually agreed upon by the two governments. The second is a cession. This is transfer of a part of a territory, and one cession takes place in peacetime, another cession may take place during wartime. So in peacetime, you may transfer territory through a sale or exchange. An example is the 1875 Treaty of St. Petersburg. In wartime, there's a transfer of territory after a peace treaty is signed that ends hostilities. And as a result of that, this always includes provisions on territory. So 1895 Treaty of Shimonoseki for the first Sino-Japanese War, 1905 Treaty of Portsmouth for the Russo-Japanese War could be given as two examples. In this case, a southern part of Sakhalin is ceded by Russia to Japan. So, what is the scope of Japan's island territories? It's quite vast. And what is shown in white is the exclusive economic zone. And we are number 11 in the world in terms of the area. And as you see on the right hand side, Ogasawara Island allows us to claim a large, vast scope of territories. And this is an area where a lot of mineral resources are being found. And the Northern Territories and Takeshima Island and the Senkaku. These islands are rather small, but I tried to make it look big just on the map. But facing the Pacific, in these islands, I would like to talk about how they have been incorporated into Japan and Japanese territory. Ogasawara Islands, we have the volcano islands and Okinotorishima Island and Minami Torishima Island, and these are what constitutes the Ogasawara Islands under the Tokyo Municipality. And 1593 is the oldest record when Sadayori Ogasawara landed on the island and erected wooden markers there, and Tokugawa Ieyasu named it Ogasawara Island and gave Sadayori this island as his fief. It was unmanned for centuries after that, but in 1830, foreigners also landed on the island, and some of them lived on the island. There were about 20 Kanakas coming from Hawaii who landed and started settling there. And the Japanese started a full-scale settlement from 1860s onwards. And people were migrated from Hachijo Island. However, in 1863, everyone evacuated or withdrew. That is, all Japanese evacuated from the island because it was difficult to develop Ogasawara. Government office was set up on the island, and laws and regulations were put in place in 1876, and the exercising of jurisdiction was notified to the foreign ambassadors, and Germany, France, Netherlands, Spain acknowledged this notification, but the United States and Britain replied that they found parts of Japan's decision to be unacceptable and protested. But not many foreign countries were interested in the islands, and therefore Japan kept its territory. In 1921, the population exceeded 7,000 people, but that was the peak of Ogasawara. As for volcano islands, the presence was known, but it was for many years a terra nullius. But in 1889, Eijiro Tanaka and a dozen more other residents of Ogasawara settled in the islands to engage in fishing and sulfur mining. And farming was conducted by growing sugarcane, coca leaves, and lemongrass. The government of Tokyo Prefecture asked the national government to make clear the extent of jurisdiction over the islands in 1891. And the national government gave names to these islands, Kita-Iwo, Iwo, and Minami-Iwo, and placed them under the authority of the Ogasawara Island government of Tokyo Prefecture, based on the cabinet decision. Foreign countries did not protest the Japanese decision at that time. And the population increased to about 1,000, but with the war, islanders were evacuated in 1944. There is a Japan Maritime Self-Defense Forces based there, but the population or the islanders never returned there. Now, Okino Torishima Island has become smaller and smaller by the year, and this has been on the Spanish chart from about 17th century, and the name was Parasevera at that time. But the island was regarded as uninhabited and not in the possession of any country. So in July 1931, the government of Japan considered this as terra nullius and placed the island under its jurisdiction of Tokyo Prefecture as part of Ogasawara's. Minami Torishima, this is located at the southernmost end of the Japanese territories. Not only expedition came there, but in 1864, a report was made of the presence of this island. And in 1896, Shinroku Mizutani drifted onto the island, and Mizutani had 23 people come from Ogasawara to relocate to the island to engage in fishing and bird hunting. In 1898, he filed for lease of the island to the government, and the government decides to incorporate the island into Tokyo Prefecture in July 1898 after receiving this petition of filing from Mizutani. In May 1902, the village of Mizutani was established on the island, and there were about 60 settlers, Japanese, who engaged in engaging in various economic activities. So, Ogasawara had visitors like Perry, Commodore Perry as well. But it's not written here, but there were views or arguments that said U.S. United States should take ownership of this island, but the discussion did not progress thereafter and remained Japanese territory. Now, Takeshima, it consists of two islets, Ojima and Mejima, in the Sea of Japan. And in the early 17th century, the Tokugawa Shogunate authorized two merchant families to conduct fishing and other economic activities in Utsuryo Island. So it was a very rich island, and much is written in the records from those days. And at that time, Takeshima was called Matsushima. The current Takeshima, therefore, was used as a stopover point going to Utsuryo Island. And but the Korean envoys requested the Shogunate that Japanese should not be traveling to Utsuryo Island. But the Shogunate did not ban people to travel to Takeshima. Nakayozaburo filed a petition with the government of Japan in 1904 to ask for Takeshima to be incorporated into Japan. And Japanese government did so, based on cabinet decision in 1905. And Nakayozaburo conducted various economic activities on the island. After this, Korea conducted various activities to come to possess the island or continue to claim the ownership of the island ever since. Now, what is the situation with Senkaku Island? It consists of eight islands, and the Imperial Japanese Navy began surveying the islands in 1885, and the Navy confirmed that the islands were not under the control of Qing Dynasty or any other country, and therefore in 1894, Koga Tatsushiro, a businessman, filed a petition with the Japanese government asking for a lease on island territory, and in 1895, the Japanese government approved in a cabinet decision to build a marker on the island and incorporate them into the country's territory. And about 200 people at its peak were carrying out various economic activities to harvest and process bonito or catch seabirds for the down feathers. In the post-war period, according to the Treaty of Peace with Japan, they were placed under U.S. administration, and China opposed against this move. In 1970, it was announced that the area around the Senkaku may have subterranean oil deposits, and all of a sudden China began to assert that the islands were long part of China and asserted territorial sovereignty over the islands. And and in 1972, the Senkakus were returned to Japan as part of Okinawa, and Japan has administered Ireland since then. As to the situation with the Northern Territories, this is Hokkaido, and there is in 1855, the Treaty of Commerce and Navigation between Japan and Russia drew the boundary between the two countries at the point between the islands of Etorofu and Urup. Russian Tsar agreed to draw the line there. As for Sakhalin, Karafto, it was placed under joint control at that time. And under the 1875 Treaty of St. Petersburg, Russia peacefully ceded the Kuril Islands to Japan in exchange of Sakhalin, Karafuto. Until World War II, about 17,000 Japanese inhabited the islands and engaged in fishing and kelp harvesting. And the Treaty of Portsmouth that ended the Russo-Japanese War divided Sakhalin at south of 50th parallel, you know, the south of 50 degrees north latitude had been ceded by coercion and became a Japanese territory. The Soviet army advanced into the Kuriles in 1945 and landed in the northern territories. The Soviets expelled the Japanese inhabitants and occupied the territories.
Now,
the war came to an end with the Potsdam Declaration, and it says that the minor islands would be determined by the Allies. But in the Cairo Declaration, it says that the Allies covet no gain for themselves and have no thought for territorial expansion. As a result of all the Cairo Declaration and Potsdam Declaration, the San Francisco Peace Treaty entered into effect, and which says that Japan, recognizing the independence of Korea, renounces all right, title, and claim to Korea, etc. And so what happened, after all, is that regarding Ogasawa's, in accordance with Article 3, Japan placed the Ogasawa's under the trusteeship system with the United States as the sole administrating authority, and the Ogasawa Islands were reverted to Japan in 1968. As for Takeshima, South Korea calls the island Dokdo, asserting that Dokdo was non-Korean territory and that it is a part of Korea which Japan renounced in accordance with the San Francisco Peace Treaty. South Korea, of course, was not a signatory to the treaty. It was found out that when the treaty was being drafted, South Korea asked the United States to have Takeshima treated as part of Korea. But the United States refused the request. South Korea asserts that SCAPIN, Supreme Command of Allied Powers Instruction Note 677 and 1033, issued during the Allied occupation of Japan, excluded Takeshima from Japanese territory. And Korea bases its justification of the ownership of Takeshima on this. Especially in number 677 and 1033, says that it is not the final decision of border demarcation. However, but despite this fact, South Korea unilaterally declared sovereignty over the waters surrounding Takeshima in January 1952 and drew the Syngman Rhee line, making Takeshima part of Korea. After the end of the war, when Japanese fishing ships started to conduct economic activities in the waters, they have been seized by the Koreans. And Japan protests very strongly against the Syngman Rhee line, but South Korea continues to occupy Takeshima by force. And in 1956, when the Treaty of Basic Relations between ROK and Japan was signed, relations were normalized, and still Takeshima remains occupied by South Korea. Now, finally, on Senkaku Island, PRC asserts that the Senkaku was discovered by China and that they form part of Taiwan, which Japan relinquished in the San Francisco Peace Treaty. And by the way, PRC was formed in 1949 after the Communist Party took power in China, so PRC was not a signatory to the San Francisco Peace Treaty. But they can say that they are the justified successor to China. Under Article 3 of the treaty, the Senkakus were placed under trusteeship along with Okinawa, and the United States served as the sole administrator. So this is Okinawa, this is the Senkaku Islands. And Senkaku Islands were returned to Japan in 1972, along with Okinawa. China declared the Senkakus to be a core national interest in 2012. And as Professor Okamoto said, they are going to come and can't take it. Tibet and Uyghur and Taiwan were mentioned as core national interest in 2009, but they have expanded that in 2012 to include Senkakus and has established an air defense identification zone over the islands. Also, in 2012, the Japanese government acquired land on some of the Senkaku Islands from their civilian owners, and Chinese ships began repeatedly entering Japanese territorial waters near Uotsuri, understanding that the Japanese government nationalized the land. It was only a state property, a land. It was not nationalized as such, but that was what China said. As for Northern Territories, Russia has not signed the San Francisco Peace Treaty. In 1945, there was a Yalta Agreement. And the Allies said that the Saline and Kuril Islands were to be returned to Soviet Union. So that's the justification for Russia's claim on these islands or the territories. In 1956, a Soviet-Japanese joint declaration was issued. In which USSR agreed to hand over the Harbor Mice and Shikotan to Japan in case after a peace treaty is signed in the future. But with the Japan-US Security Treaty being signed, Russia took that word back, saying that they would not accept the situation in which there may be possibility that the American forces may be stationed on the Northern Territories. So now the two governments are in negotiation over these Russian the Northern Territories now occupied by Russia. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Takai. Now let us turn to Professor Sakai. Thank you very much. I am Sakai with Kyoto University. My area of specialty is international law. So today in this symposium on East Asian territorial and maritime issues and international, I'd like to give a short presentation. In this report of mine, I would like to review the international law concerning territorial and maritime issues in East Asia and consider the role of international law in those issues. First, international law for territorial issues and that for maritime issues cover different contents, and the details are given in the paper, so please look at them later. And such international law is concretized through the international customary law and treaties, and they are also reconfirmed through the rulings in international tribunals or state practices. International law has a substantive aspect of governing the issues, but at the same time, international law provides a mechanism of procedures to resolve conflict between the states.
Now,
international law and territorial issues.
Well,
traditionally, international law sets out the set of rules that determine which territory belongs to which state. And the important concept here is a title. Professor Takai has already explained what title is, and it is a fact which supports effective exercise of a territorial sovereignty. And it comes in different types, occupation, acquisition, secession, and prescription. For certain time periods, discovery and subjugation may also be considered as a title. And some parties to a conflict or dispute may also assert their claims based upon historic titles which come from historic facts. China, in the case mentioned earlier, used historic facts and historic rights. And also, in some cases, although this is not strictly a title, especially in international tribunals, a notion of effective occupation has been utilized. And as was pointed out in 1928, the island of Palmas case in international tribunals, a effective occupation or continuous and peaceful display of territorial sovereignty is considered important. In a dispute, which title or claim is stronger than the other? Such a comparison is often done. And if that is not enough, then a continuous and peaceful display of territorial sovereignty or effectivities were taken into consideration in international tribunals. No. About international forum for dispute resolution. For territorial disputes, besides negotiation between parties, the third party mechanism and institutions such as ICJ and state-to-state arbitration fora are used. But the use of such a third-party mechanism requires consent of the parties to a dispute. Sovereign state has the freedom to select the means of dispute resolution, so court jurisdiction over such a matter can be established only with the consent of all other parties to a dispute. Furthermore, there is no enforcement institution in the international society for a implementation of a arbitral award or judicial rulings. Therefore, the final resolution of dispute is, after all, left with the consent of the parties to a dispute. As important procedural rules of international law, there is the principle of intertemporal law and also the notion of critical date. Intertemporal law provides that international law valid at that point in time and needs to be interpreted and applied. In the Island of Palmas arbitration case, a distinction was made between the creation and existence of rights and international law
applicable for each time period had to be identified. On the other hand, a critical date refers to the date when a dispute erupted or when a territorial sovereignty was crystallized. Its attribution was crystallized. For instance, in 1953 ICJ ruling of a Manquier-Écluyer case between UK and France. It was stated that, in principle, facts prior to the critical date needs to be considered, but depending upon the specific nature of a case, acts and facts after a critical date may also be considered. Now, on East Asia territorial issues, first, let me start with the Takeshima Island issues. The dispute over those islands erupted between the two countries in 1952 when Korea issued a proclamation of a maritime sovereignty, as Professor Takai mentioned, that is the establishment of a Shinmanri line and a Japanese protest against it. And if we follow the definition of a critical date, as I explained earlier, 1952 would be considered a critical date for Takeshima Islands dispute. What are the claims of the two countries over these islands? Japan argues that Takeshima has been under Japanese possession since the opening of the country, and in 1905, Japan incorporated the islands into Japanese territory and made public notice of it. On the other hand, ROK acknowledges the presence of no such dispute, but it also argues that even before 1905, territorial incorporation by Japan, it has possessed the islands, and also those islands, according to them, are part of the territory over which Japan renounced its sovereignty in the 1951 peace treaty. If drawing a Shinmanri line is proven to be a challenge against Japan's sovereignty, then by applying critical date strictly, all acts after that critical date will fall out of legal consideration, and Japan may be able to win a ruling in its favor. Now, on Senkaku Islands. As shown in my handouts, there are various developments over the years. I will not go into the details. Now, Japanese arguments. Japan has never acknowledged a presence of any dispute over Senkaku Islands. And since its incorporation into Japanese territory through the principle of occupation of terra nullius, it has been holding those islands under effective possession. On the other hand, PRC, China, argues that those islands have been historically part of China and also a part of Taiwan, which according to them, Japan renounced in San Francisco Peace Treaty. Today, it is Japan which has effective occupation of the islands, and if 1971, when the PRC launched a protest against Japan as a critical date, then Japanese effective occupation afterwards would be adopted as an evidence that confirms the legal status of those islands prior to the critical date. Therefore, at a third-party institution, Japanese territorial rights over those islands may be accepted. Now on Northern Islands.
Japan and Russia has concluded various treaties as shown in this table.
So, in a sense, the territorial issues between the two countries is chiefly
an issue of a treaty interpretation. In Article 2, Section C of a peace treaty in San Francisco, Japan renounced all rights, title, and claims to Kuril Islands. And the Japanese government argues that those Kuril Islands are islands of Uruk and to the north of Uruk. And based upon the Japan-Russia Treaty of Commerce, island Etorofu and islands to the south of Etorofu are Japanese inherent territories. On the other hand, Russia argues that all four northern islands were reverted to the Soviet Union through Japan's unconditional surrender and occupation. And as Professor Takai mentioned, Japan-Soviet joined the Declaration of 1956 states that upon the conclusion of peace treaty between the two countries, Habama Islands and Shikotai Islands will be handed over to Japan. So we have to wait for a further progress in the negotiation between Japan and Russia over this matter. Now, maritime issues and international law. Very briefly, upon the history of our law of the sea. It has a long history, but it developed substantially after the end of World War II. In 1945, the then President of the United States, Truman, argued and stated that the United States has the right to seabed mining and a right to conserve fishing resources in its coast. And in 1956, four Geneva Conventions on the Law of the Sea were adopted in 1982 after a little over 10 years of negotiation, and UNCLOS was adopted as the Constitution of the Sea. And UNCLOS today sets the basis for maritime legal order, and in exchange for the extended jurisdiction of the coastal states and a formation of a deep seabed regime, in exchange for such systems, some systems such as the freedom of innocent passage and transit passage in international straits were introduced, which were more or less in favor of the big maritime countries. So, in the field of international maritime law, various universal and regional treaties were adopted issue by issue, and they all form a kind of network that together form a maritime legal order today. There are some important features concerning maritime legal regime today. One is a use of zoning for the application of international law. Before that, there were only two zones, territorial or sea, overstate and the high seas. But today, besides them, there are other zones. So in a sense, it's now a multi-zonal order. The second feature is as follows. Degrees of jurisdiction of coastal states vary zone by zone. For instance, in territorial sea, a coastal state exercises its sovereignty comprehensively, whereas in EEZ and coastal shelves, a coastal state has its jurisdiction only on fishing resources and non-living resources. The third feature is that the present maritime legal regime was formed against the background of balancing the interests of coastal states and freedom of navigation. United States operates free navigation of naval vessels in various waters today, in a sense to reconfirm the interests of a flag state vis-à-vis the title of a coastal state. Issues of marine resources management and distribution has given rise to a new issue, that is the maritime boundary delimitation. In 1958, Convention on Continental Shelf provides for an equidistance principle for the delimitation of a overlapped continental shelves. But in 1969, ICJ ruling on North Sea, our consideration was given to West Germany, which was given a disadvantage when the only equidistance principle was applied. And so in that ruling, the notion of natural prolongation was emphasized, and also a principle of equity was put forward. In UNCLOS, it speaks of an equitable solution to be achieved through the consensus of countries concerned, and also in subsequent rulings, there emerged a tension between equidistance, the median line principle, and the principle of equity and relevant circumstances. At the end of the day, in 2009, as if to merge those two approaches, in ICJ ruling on Black Sea demarcation case, adopted three-stage approach. This approach was already explained by Mr. Reichler, but if I may reiterate, the first step is to draw a provisional median line and to make adjustment to achieve a equitable solution. And lastly, a proportionality test is applied to consider the length of the relevant coasts and maritime areas. This three-step approach has been adopted in Italos and various maritime boundary delimitation cases in international arbitration. Now on fishing issues, fisheries issues in East Asia. Between Japan and South Korea, with the establishment of the Shinman Rhee line, the relationship became really sour. But in 1965, two countries concluded the fisheries agreement, which established the EEZ up to 12 miles from each coast. And then, in line with the adoption of UNCLOS in 1998, a new fisheries agreement was reached between the two countries, which is still valid today. Between Japan and the PRC, since after the diplomatic normalization between Japan and China in 1975, a fisheries agreement was concluded. And also, in line with the provisions of UNCLOS, a new fisheries agreement was signed in 1997. This agreement sets a provisional measure zone between the two countries and set the ground for a preservation and management measures of biological resources. The interesting relationship between Japan and Taiwan, there is no diplomatic relationship between the two, so treaty cannot be formed. So in 2013, a more or less semi governmental organizations of the two countries formed and signed a fisheries agreement. And there are also continental shelf issues in East Asia. for non-living resources, the countries concerned need to conclude an agreement for a development of management. In 1974, Japan and ROK reached an agreement which set forth a joint development zone in the south, a part of the sea. The problem or question here is the continental shelf between Japan and China in East China Sea. There is an overlap of the two continental shelves between the two countries, as was mentioned by Mr. Reichler. Japan argues for a median line, whereas China claims the use of natural prolongation to Okinawa Trough. But as has been stated in recent international rulings, three-stage approach has been adopted, and from that criteria, Chinese seem to be overclaiming its continental shelves. According to the definition by UNCLOS, a state may set the outer edge of the continental shelf beyond 200 nautical miles. But in order to achieve such an extension of the continental shelf beyond 200 miles, the coastal state needs to make a submission with sufficient data to COCS. In 2008, Japan made this submission to the committee for seven zones, including Okino-Torishima area. Against this, China and ROK objected that Okino-Torishima is not an island, therefore cannot generate continental shelf. COCS in 2012 approved extension of the continental shelves in its recommendation to Japan in areas other than Okino-Torishima south. And this issue has an important connection with the legal standing of Okino-Torishima. This island is the southernmost island of Japan, 1,700 kilometers south of Tokyo, a coral reef island. Its periphery is 10 kilometers long and east to west 4.5 kilometers and north to south 1.7 kilometers at the biggest. At high tide, two parts of the island stay above the waters. Japan considers this as Okino-Torishima, and it also argues that it is an island from the definition of UNCLOS. On the other hand, Korea and China argues that it's not an island according to UNCLOS. In this regard, the interpretation of Article 121 of UNCLOS is very important, as it was shown in the South China Sea Arbitral Award spoken about by Mr. Reichler. But in this arbitral award, there is no active definition of ROC, and also the purpose of EEZ was incorporated into the interpretation of this article, and there was no consideration given to a state practice. So we need to see how this arbitral award would impact the subsequent state practices. So, in summary, there are 4 points I would like to make through my contribution. Number one, territorial and maritime issues are both governed by international law. Secondly, the role of international law in those regards is to provide a code of conduct for sovereign states, among others, and encourage them to take a rule-based behaviors and acts and provide a criteria of resolving the issues when a dispute arises. Number three is the compliance with such international law would contribute to the stability of international society. regional society and be conducive to the development of international law. Number four, international law resolves only a legal aspect of a dispute. In order to resolve the whole dispute, not just international law, but other criteria and perspectives need to be brought into. Thank you very much.
Professor Sakai, thank you very much. Law, we have heard from the professors specializing in law and history, but it's rather difficult to limit their time. As organizer, if I may suggest that we extend the time frame of this symposium to be extended by 15 minutes, if that's okay with all of you. And also, may I ask everyone else to speak within 3 to 5 minutes in making comments after this? And so I would invite Professor Agawa and Professor Murata to give comments as discussants, and we'll allow the three panelists to respond. And I would be asking Mr. Reichler and Professor Sakamoto to give comments to conclude, and hope that we would have as much time as possible for free discussion. So I would like to speak in 3 minutes. Please remind me if I'm past the time. I've never spoken in 3 minutes, though. The role that is given to me is for time adjustment. So I would like to be as brief as possible. I'm not an expert specializing in this area, and therefore I would like to give my impressions. I had a chance to talk with the Dutch ambassador, and of course we were to speak about Senkaku, but it was interesting that they said that the ICJ is based in the Netherlands. They are very keen about complying with international law, Netherlands was beaten by the British so bad, and therefore when you are beaten and in a weak position, we tend to abide with the international law. So why China would not withdraw from UNCLOS was a question that was addressed. And why is it that Japan is keen on keeping its position in UNCLOS? And also, may I also talk about why Japan may be interested in various cases around the world on borders and territories? I think all countries are interested, based on national interest, to save their territory. And I believe it was a good thing that the South China Sea situation could be linked to the East China Sea situation. And by learning from that, we would be able to share the experience that procedures could be taken to take steps to secure one's own territory. And so it was a learning experience. And so we never know what China will be doing in Senkaku, but I believe we can study a lot from what happened in the South China Sea arbitration case. And also, we may be involved somewhat in the South China Sea with the self-defense forces, and going past the South China Sea, we are interested in international arbitration because we cannot contribute militarily speaking. We won't be using military force, and therefore Japan-U.S. Relations, international relations is what we can work on. Even though it may not be directly an issue that involves Japan, Japan has started to realize that it is important to play a role in whatever means possible. So it is a proactive peace policy. And in case I think all of these territory issues may be linked to Senkaku. In other words, Minami Torishima, we don't know what is going to happen to that for Japan, but lose some, win some is a principle. And also, we have been trying to abide with the international law, but during the Manchurian incident, Japan, the whole world did not accept Japan's position. So I think we have had a lesson to learn from these experiences in the past. Perhaps we need to cherish idealism. But to be realistically ideal, I think international law could be used as a means. And there may be a possibility of having resolution to a dispute without the fighting wars. And I think no man is an island in time on itself. Everyone is a part of the continent, the British poet said. And we should not be thinking all by ourselves. But of course, we may don't want to favor China or give advantage to China. I think we need to have a legitimacy in the world, and together, we need to think about international law from the standpoint of hard power as well as from soft power, I guess. Thank you very much.
So I'll be quick also. We received a tense explanation about international law. As a political scientist, I'd like to give you the following comments. The maritime and territorial issues in this particular part of the world is very difficult, and power balance is rapidly changing as a backdrop to this difficulty. And as I heard from the China's history, and be it Japan, Sino-Japanese War and World War II were fought, and at the very final battle of World War II, Japan lost, and Japanese people are still somewhat dissatisfied with that end. And Chinese people, I think, also harbor a kind of frustration over the history. And from a Korean point of view, the Japan-Korean Treaty was concluded based upon the power balance back in those days. So in a sense, constitution was forced onto Japan by the United States during the time of occupation. Some Japanese people have a sense of dissatisfaction, and such a mood of feelings people have hovered over years cannot be neglected when we consider such disputes. And a very precise discussion concerning international law is very important, but at the same time, we need to make translation, not only language translation. We need to translate what international law says in a plain language which people on the streets understand, and that's very difficult. And we need to consider the public opinion of our own country and the public opinion of the other country, and also the public opinion of the whole international community. And we have to apply different thoughts of translation into a plain language. We need to explain our claims in a plain language which is understandable to the people of the other country. We also need to explain to our own people in a plain language why the other party makes such and such arguments. We need to use the language and the persuasion which would encourage both parties to come to a negotiation ground. Emotions are really important when we consider such a dispute. As is often said by Professor Takashi Shiraishi, some Chinese people receive Western education, and some respect the values and sense of values of the Western style. Those what is called Anglo-Chinese is the kind of audience we need to speak to in order to indirectly influence a big country such as China. In a sense, this is a soft power approach. But in order not to allow the other party to change the status quo so easily in a unilateral way, we need to use hard power. In other words, we have to utilize Japan-U.S. alliance And as was shown in the Japan defense guideline, we need to take into consideration the development of Japanese military powers. I have questions to international law specialists. And how will international law is developed for the control and governance of cyber conflicts, and the Japanese Coast Guard has enjoyed expansion of budget under the current administration, but 250 billion yen budget, that's the Japan Coast Guard and Tokyo University, has more or less the same size of annual budget, and with that such a small budget, they have to protect 6,852 islands, and Harvard University is more or less having the same level of a budget to organize the university. So it's really a difficult job for Japan Coast Guard to protect all the islands with such a small budget.
I'm Okamoto. Probably I have no answer for your question, but thank you very much for the comments from Professor Agawa and Professor Murata. I was very impressed with what you had to say. But regarding the point about telling the Japanese, one's own population about the other country's feelings and mood, that is not successful in my case. Trying to talk about what China's views are and China's thinking about, I still have difficulties doing that myself. So I would like to tell you why that is difficult in responding to your question or comments. The reason why China is difficult, I believe, comes in different levels. First of all, the so-called Anglo-Chinese may be a typical case. China itself is so diversified, multifaceted in nature, the government people, the intellectuals, and the general population, the foreign Chinese living overseas. I believe you can take them all as different people, not the same Chinese. And so, in another way, perhaps China needs to assert itself as being one China in order to keep these people together intact. So we are facing all sorts of different China, and the question is how can a monolithic Japan face a country like that? That's one. And we have our own circumstances, the students here in Japan do not read the Chinese character so well nowadays. So they are not able to read Chinese and the Chinese characters, not being able to follow the mentality of the Chinese people. Of course, I still have my own problems as not being able to read so well and understand China well myself. But given that situation, the question is, what can we learn? So not only the Japan Coast Guard, I hope that we would be given a budget for us so that we can conduct our own studies and research more fully. Thank you very much for the comments, and thank you very much for your question. Now, of course, regarding the international law, we tend to be cautious in incorporating the territories. Of course, I believe it is not always the case. International law, it's only international law. That's a good way of putting it. But I think Mr. Reichler also talked about the difficulties of understanding China. But I think China is fighting in law and also working in the salami strategy, changing the strategy little by little, changing the situation little by little to their advantage. They are fighting with information as well, information war. And so I think it's an overall strategy when China tries to expand overseas. As Professor Murata mentions, when they have power, they tend to expand. But when they don't have the power, they would tend to be quiet and try to watch the timing. And therefore, when we fight in legal terms, the question as to how we can be successful. As Professor Sakamoto mentioned, international law is still ambiguous in many ways. And so China is trying to take advantage of these ambiguities. And they come up with their own national laws and they try to influence the international law with their power. And so the question is, how can we come up with an international law that can fight against these unilateral measures? And also, when we think about the Chinese history in the South China Sea, I think it was immediately after the United States withdrew from the region that the power vacuum was taken advantage of. And in case of Senkaku, in 2012, China asserted that it is a core national interest of theirs, and therefore they will come eventually. And they are looking at the Kamchatka Peninsula, or even going far as Los Angeles, in their view of coming up with maps as to how far China can assert their territory. And therefore, it's really difficult for us to assess what they're thinking about. But against Japan, Senkaku, if Senkaku is the most vulnerable, and I think unless we do have the Japan-U.S. alliance, China may not venture such a move. But with Trump administration, we don't know what is going to happen. Or up till now, we're not really sure about what the United States move will be when China was to take the move. So we just really have to depend on the Japan-U.S. alliance, and Japan, I guess the Japanese government would have to rely on the United States to help. And there is, regarding the starting rule, cyber is an area how as where we are not able to really pinpoint the person who is making the attack. So when we think about the self defense, it's very difficult, and there is no strict rule as such. What regards what you said about the Japan Coast Guard, we need to. We would ask for various materials to be disclosed from the Japanese government, but not much has been disclosed so far. In 1952, when the patrol boat had been shot at with many bullet holes, they won't show us the pictures. They wouldn't give us the details as to what has happened. So it's very difficult to get the information out of the Japanese government on these matters. Thank you very much for the question and for your comment. As a scholar of international law, I would not be able to add so much. But regarding territorial matters, I would like to talk about a few things that I was not able to report on. Regarding territorial disputes or in asserting territories, what is important, as I would see it, is one, effectiveness. Second, legitimacy. And unless you have the two of them, you will not be able to persuade the other party or the international community. Unfortunately, international law, as I have said in my report, the sovereign country, sovereign state, would only abide by the law when it's in its national interest. And therefore, for their own national benefit, when its effectiveness can be maintained, then they would be able to keep the territory and abide with the international law. But when unlawful means are used to acquire territory, that is not acceptable, and therefore legitimacy needs to be there. So effectiveness and legitimacy are two important points. But in addition to that, I would also say that international law, detailed discussion is important, as Professor Murata mentioned, but we can only discuss a narrow, limited area. We are always on a passive stance as against the power balance. International law is not something that you can expect too much on, but in diplomatic negotiations, I think as a common language, you can make quite good use of international law. And therefore, I think that is how you should use international law as a tool. Thank you very much.
I'm sorry that I asked you to be quick, but now I'd like to turn to Mr. Reckler and Professor Sakamoto to give us a general comment. But I have one request. My area of specialty is modern China. But we tend to be pessimistic when we consider and discuss modern China. John Donne was quoted as a British poet by Professor Takai. On the part of pessimism, perhaps I can quote a poem from William Blake, Born in an Endless Night. So that is a pessimistic feeling that seems to prevail in the field of modern China studies. So I would like you to give us some encouraging comments, Professor Sakamoto and Mr. Reckler, please. Well, I don't think it's easy for me to live up to your request and expectation, but I'd like to make 3 points. Japan is the only country which uses Chinese characters besides China proper. But Professor Libby, a former director of Japan Research Institute of China Academy, said to me as follows, person's way of thinking is regulated not by letters, but by grammar. English and Chinese grammars are very similar to each other. For Chinese people, American discussion is very easy to follow. But Japanese argument is understandable to a Chinese person only when they listen to the very end of the Japanese speech. But even after, at the end of the speech, they can never understand what the Japanese person was saying, he said. And we form an association of a study of international law, and we already have held a joint workshop 7 times with a Chinese counterpart. Chinese young scholars, for instance, Anglo-Chinese scholars, in the field of international law dialogue, we do have a very sound relationship, but the current Chinese government is very high-handed upon such studies. Recently, a British press publisher, and we had an editorial meeting because we and the Chinese colleagues were planning to publish a book together, but this publisher asked us not to make any mentioning reference to the territorial disputes between China and Japan. But actually, that was the request received through our colleague in China. And this shows the high-handed crackdown approach by the current Chinese government. Now, Chinese construction of patrol boats is much faster than the construction of the same kind of boat by Japan. Recently, in the areas around the Senkaku Islands, against China's offensive, Japan is doing a one-on-one defense. But in the near future, such a one-boat-to-one-boat defense will be very difficult to be successful. We have a lot of students here. So China is more or less slowing down in economic development, but according to a book written by authors, including Professor Asano, after 2030, China's GDP would be as big as American GDP. And by that time, although Japan was used to be called Japan as number one, when Japan had 10% of the global GDP, but by 2030, Japanese GDP's ratio to the world would be down to 5%. Under such circumstances, the future prospects in East Asia vis-a-vis ROK and vis-a-vis PRC in such international relationship in this part of the world, how wisely can Japan behave? And international law in that regard is a very important tool for Japan to consider our future course of actions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. My first comment is that this was just a wonderful presentation by all three of you professors. I learned a tremendous amount, and I am very grateful to all of you for your outstanding presentations. I greatly enjoyed Professor Okamoto's historical analysis of China's approach to territorial sovereignty. One thing that stood out to me, which may have relevance to Japanese-Chinese relations, was the understanding in the early 19th and late 19th century that one of the tributaries was the Ryukyus. I know Professor Asano has asked us for reasons to be optimistic. This might not comply with his request, but the concern that I had, particularly as Professor Okamoto, I think very convincingly displayed that some of the Chinese government's current attitudes toward territorial sovereignty seem to be rooted in the past, in an effort to recover the past dominance or territorial expansion. So if what Professor Okamoto said in his response to a question about and Professor Takai mentioned about the China's focus on the Senkaku, is that a precursor to an even more aggressive claim toward the Ryukyus? I would hope not, but it gave me some, at least, food for thought about that potentiality. I think that's an important subject that you have raised. I also want to compliment Professor Takai and Professor Sakai for their really excellent presentation on the controversies over islands, particularly the controversies between Japan and China, Japan and South Korea, Japan and Russia. I would like to offer this observation, provoked by your presentations, but also based in part on my experience in dealing with disputes over territorial sovereignty in different parts of the world, as an advocate for one side or the other, but developing a certain perspective. First, disputes over territorial sovereignty, whether they be continental or islands, are extremely, extremely difficult to resolve by negotiation. There are many factors which make this difficult, but among them is the fact that if we focus on sovereignty, sovereignty is not a concept that is divisible, that can be shared. And it is either it's what we call a zero-sum game, win or lose. And this is very difficult for any government. Even a government, even two governments, that in good faith are seeking a solution, a solution on a territorial dispute inevitably involves some compromise, because State A is not going to accept everything State B demands, nor is State B going to accept everything State A demands. Even skilled and good faith negotiators who see a middle ground that is reasonable, it's almost impossible to convince one's government, and beyond the government, the population, to accept any surrender of any aspect of sovereignty. So these are enormously challenging disputes, no matter how valid Japan's claims may be. And you have made an absolutely convincing case, and you certainly have convinced me that Japan has the superior claims in all three instances, Senkaku, Takashima, and the Northern Territories. But how do you get, how do you make progress? Of course, one continues to develop the case, the facts and the law, and continues to press it. But are there interim steps that can be taken to at least diffuse or minimize the conflict and make an armed or military solution less likely? And I draw some thoughts from my experience in analyzing the situation of the islands in the South China Sea. The Spratlys are claimed by several different states. Every one of the islands is claimed by China. Every one is claimed by Vietnam. About 30 of them are claimed by the Philippines. Malaysia also has some claims. Although it is proceeded in fits and starts, there is an effort by the ASEAN group on the one hand and together with China to agree upon what they call a code of conduct. Now, the idea is that there would be no effort militarily to take any islands that are not presently under one's control. So that this is an important element. The code of conduct is still being negotiated, and it doesn't exist yet. But as we look at the history of that negotiation and what the states are trying to achieve, it seems to me that one element is some mutual understanding that neither state, none of the states involved, will seek a military solution. There may be other ways to diffuse or reduce tensions or reduce the possibility of military confrontation. Sovereignty, as I said, is indivisible, but sovereignty is carries with it a certain number of attributes. For example, access to resources, whether in the island itself or in surrounding waters. And certain of these attributes are divisible. It is possible to reach agreement, even as sovereignty is disputed, on sharing the access to the fish, or even joint ventures in terms of drilling for oil or hydrocarbons. It may be possible for states to put aside or put to one side the sovereignty dispute over the island itself, but still reach agreements on access to resources. Another possibility is if the island is not inhabited, the states might agree not to put or establish civilian settlements. They might even agree to make it an environmentally protected zone. This is actually a concept that was put forward by Taiwan for the islands of the South China Sea. Another way of minimizing the tendency of the sovereignty dispute to create wider problems is to agree on maritime delimitation without giving weight to these small and uninhabited islands. For example, a median line in the East China Sea between China and Japan might be drawn based on equidistance, but without giving effect one way or the other to the senkakus. In these ways, it might be possible to reach agreements on certain of the aspects or the benefits, if you will, of sovereignty, and therefore minimize or mitigate the importance of who is actually sovereign. Now, that of course will remain an active dispute, but perhaps if these types of approaches are considered, the possibility of confrontation would be minimized. And I thank you for causing me to think about this. I hope my thoughts are interesting and lead, perhaps cause you to think further about it. But independently of what I've just said, I just learned a tremendous amount, and I'm really glad I got a chance to listen to all of you. I feel greatly enriched by having heard your presentations, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Reichler. Well, actually, it would have been proper if, to give three speakers to respond to the comments, but because of the time limits, we'd like to open the floor for questions and comments. And therefore, I would like to encourage the attendees to give questions, raise comments to the speakers. 1 minute at the most to each person. Shorter the question is, the better. Or spare you. Some may have to leave very quickly, so I'd like to prioritize those who have to leave quickly. Professor Hiroshi Nakaichi, I had just an eye contact with you, so you are the first person. This is not a question, but rather a comment in my observation. Mr. Reichler, as he said toward the end of the comments, for international law or for international politics, the basic fundamental question is how to redefine a concept of sovereignty. And Professor Okamoto, on the other hand, used the notion of territorial sovereignty for China case. In the 20th century political science, sovereignty wasn't defined clearly. It was reduced into a concept which gives grounds to rights. Of course, that's a very basic part of the concept of sovereignty, but I think it's time for us to redefine the notion of sovereignty. And, well, British Brexit, I think, is a very good example which demands us to consider the notion of sovereignty. The United Kingdom might have thought that they would be able to get back sovereignty, but now, in reality, it's so difficult for them to do that. So, in light of the present-day reality of the international politics, we need to consider and redefine sovereignty and what can be balanced vis-à-vis sovereignty. Otherwise, it's going to be really difficult for the international community to come to any agreement. That's my comment. Perhaps we should receive comments or questions from the floor all at once before asking panelists to respond. Professor Sakamoto. Thank you very much for a very enlightening presentations. It's very clear-cut, all of them. My response, comment is about the international law on the offensive side, for a fighting side. It's important that we claim that that is our island, but on the other hand, from the international law perspective, it is important to assert that that is not your island either, especially Northern Territories, as in light of the San Francisco Peace Treaty. It's not that we abandon the sovereignty over the Kuril Islands. We renounced the title to those islands from the sovereignty of Japan, but it's not that we give them to Russia. So some may argue for the absolute nature of sovereignty, but it's also important that we would continue to say that this may not be our island, but that is not your island either. And I think that sort of argumentation is very important. San Francisco Peace Treaty in Article 2, I support the Japanese government stance in this regard, and I think Japan can win the case if that is brought to an international court. But actually, in a way, Japanese government is arguing is against the reality of what really happened in history. So state, history, identity, and sovereignty, those are very interesting themes. Any other questions or comments? A student? Thank you very much for the presentations. My name is Shinka Ukon, a student of political science at the Faculty of Law of Doshisha University. I'd like to make some comments on the extension of the discussion on the issue of sovereignty. So how should I start? Earlier, on the question in history to the development of notion of territorial sovereignty by Professor Okamoto. As Professor Okamoto said, in China, the concept of territorial sovereignty was born only 100 years ago, a very short history indeed, but such a legal notion or concept like a sovereignty, I think, has a lot longer history. But in Asia, the notion of sovereignty has a short history. As a result, Japanese or Asian countries try to emphasize their interpretation of sovereignty, and because of the insufficient understanding of sovereignty or international law, arbitrary interpretation of such a notion, I think, tends to take place in some Asian countries. I think we need to get the questions or comments first from the floor, and later we'd like to turn to Professor Okamoto or other relevant speakers for response. One or two more questions or comments?
Anyone with additional questions or comments? Please use the opportunity. Professor Okamoto, would you please respond then? Mr. Reichler, thank you very much for your comments. I would like to talk about Ryukyu, Okinawa. As for Senkaku, we have had presentations on Senkaku, so I think we can leave it for that. But as for Okinawa and the Chinese view on Okinawa, this is multi-layered, according to my interpretation. I think, according to China, I think they are one in saying that Okinawa does not belong to Japan. But going a bit further, whether or not China claims territory and sovereignty of Okinawa, we are not really sure as to whether they would go that far. Now, I think this is related to Fanshu, countries dependent on China's sovereignty or hegemony. Probably China, based on international law, is not able to claim sovereignty on Okinawa. But on a private level, who are interested in history, I think it shows on the map. In other words, Fanshu means that it's a part of their territory. So, domestically speaking, within China, in terms of governance, I think vis-à-vis Japan or vis-à-vis Okinawa, they may have to come out being more offensive, and which is worrisome, because they need to govern the country as one. So I think China is not monolithic in their views. And vis-à-vis Okinawa, I would say that some people say that their territory, but there are others who say it's not their territory. So I think Japan needs to understand these different levels of Chinese views on Okinawa. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We would like to spend more time, but the time is running, and therefore we would like to close the panel discussion here. I would like to thank the panelists and the discussants for their presentations and comments. Thank you very much.
If I may just add one word. Professor Murata said over lunch that this is an area where Muromachi Bakufu, or the shogunate, government was located. We are here at the past center of Japanese politics. And the fact that here we are holding this symposium on a territory, might end up ultimately in the future where our names will be put on metal plates somewhere up in the university to mark this event. So with that note, I will give up the microphone to the moderator. Thank you very much. So I'd like to ask Mr. Nakayama to give a closing remark. Professor Asano has already
wrapped up the symposium, I would say, with witty remarks. But although I do not have anything to add as an organizer, I would nevertheless like to give this closing remark. Thank you very much indeed for your attendance to the symposium, in spite of today being a Saturday. We have been very happy to welcome Mr. Reichler, distinguished practitioner in arbitration. And also, we have been grateful to have heard from the distinguished speakers in the panel. And I believe this was a very fruitful meeting indeed. And there was a mention about the Muromachi government. We are holding this type of symposium in Japan as well as elsewhere. And as for my personal view on the symposium, I was very impressed by the fact that we were able to have such an interdisciplinary discussion and debate on this very important topic here in Kyoto. I believe it's a magnet that Kyoto has to attract such academic scholars to this place. And I personally was very much impressed by the breadth and depth of the discussion. JIIA would like to continue holding this sort of forum, which allows people to speak freely on these type of subjects. And personally, I hope we could have another symposium here in Kyoto next year. As we have heard from panelists today, in order to send out Japanese views from Japan to the outside world, we would need to think more seriously about how to express ourselves more widely to the rest of the world. Mr. Reichler has pointed the importance of this, and I hope that JIIA would be able to make a contribution towards that end. I would like to thank you all for your participation. Thank you.
With this,
we end our symposium. Thank you very much.